So this is the first video in the series on vector calculus where we just use homework problems. We're just going to do problems, and by doing these problems, we describe what's going on, we learn what's going on, and I think that's really the way to tackle it, because really in a textbook, what are you going to see? You're going to see 1 plus 1, but then the exams you're going to be asked to do some differential equation, and that's usually how textbooks work. It's only by going through the problems at the back of each chapter that you really start to understand what's going on. So that's what we're going to do here. So we're just going to do problem after problem, and we explain what's going on by doing these problems. So in this first one, we're going to look at parametric equations, how to go from a normal function, well, I would say normal function, in other words, the ones that we're used to, and how to convert them into a set of parametric equations. And then we're also going to plot a few. Now, we're not going to do that with pen and paper, although I suppose in tests and exams, that's what you're supposed to do, and at least learn how to do that. But, you know, it's tedious, it takes a long time, and that means you don't do a lot of those, and you don't get the chance to experience what's going on. In other words, using a computer to do that, you can just draw these things very quickly, and you can iterate over a bunch of them and see what the differences are by changing some of the values. So it's worthwhile to learn how to do that with a computer, so you can do that with Desmos Calculator or GeoGebra or any of these software packages online, but I'm also going to show you in this one at least how to use the Wolfram language. So you can just open a free account on the Wolfram Cloud. I'll show you a little bit about that, and we're just going to do some of these parametric curves just using a computer language. So in this first problem, we're going to find the parametric equations for the equation y equals x squared. So we're all familiar with y equals x squared. If I can just take some time and try and draw it here on the left-hand side, let's do that, and you know, it's very, very simple, but I think we're going to use this first example just to sort of figure out what is going on here. What do we mean by the fact that we say we want parametric equations? So we know y equals x squared, and we know if x is 0, then y is 0. Remember, these are two both real number lines, so as an equation, or at least as a function, remember the function would then be f of x equals x squared, and what it does is it takes a value from the set of real numbers and it maps it to another element of the real numbers. So if I input 1, 0, it's 0. If I input 1, it's going to be 1. If I input negative 1, it's going to still be 1. If I do 2, we're going to have 4. If I do negative 2 squared is 4, and 3 squared is 9. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. It's going to be way up there, and it's going to be way up here. So there we have sort of this parabola, and we all know how difficult these things are to draw. There we go. That's what we have, y equals x squared. But now we want to parameterize it. We want a parameter, and what the parameter is going to do is it's just going to allow us to move along this, and we use move in quotation marks because this is all kind of abstract. So the first thing that we're really going to do is we've got to find these equations, or we've got to find these two parametric equations. So in a simple case like this, the very first thing would be just to say x equals t. And if x equals t, that means we have the fact that y equals t squared. And there we have it. We have the two parametric equations. It's really as simple as that when it comes to a problem like this. So let's just see if we write down our parametric equation now. Remember, it's y comma x. And that's just going to be t comma t squared. And remember, your x goes to positive infinity and your goes to negative infinity this side. So we've got to have the fact that t is on this open interval from negative infinity to positive infinity. So what does this all mean? How does this, and this is our final solution, remember, that's how we write two parametric equations here. What does it mean? Well, if t is 0, then, you know, if we plug in t equals 0, we'll be here by 0, 0. So we're still down here as far as on this curve is concerned. So when t equals 1, we move all the way up and we're now there. When t is 2, we go all the way up there. And when t is 3, we go all the way up there. And so we're only showing integer values here, but anything in between as far as this t is concerned, it just means we are at different spots here. We're just moving along this curve. And that's what a parametric equation is. As simple as that, we have now a parameter that allows us to be somewhere on this curve, depending on the value of that parameter. So here we have problem number two. Instead of the very simple polynomial we had, we just have something slightly more complicated here. We see an order 2 polynomial, degree 2 polynomial, y equals x squared plus 3x plus 2. Again, just a parabola, it's a shifted a bit. And again, it's going to be very, very simple as far as what we have to do. We have to find values for x and values for y, and they're both functions of t. And again, it's very easy just to set x equals t. And if x is set to t, we just substitute wherever we see x, we substitute a t in there. So y is going to be t squared plus 3t plus 2, as simple as that. And now for our final solution, remember we weren't told specifically as far as x is concerned what the interval is, or the domain of this function then. So we can just write x, y, and that's going to equal t, t squared plus 3t plus 2, and then negative infinity less than t less than positive infinity. And that is the final solution. So again, it's very simple. When it comes to these polynomials, all we're going to do is just write some function of x with respect to t, and just whatever we chose there, we can just put in there. And I just want to show you, we could just as well do something else. Let's do that. Let's say we're going to make x equals t plus 1. There's nothing wrong with doing that. That's going to make my y a bit more complex, because every time we see x, we have to put in t plus 1. So that's going to be t plus 1 squared plus 3 times t plus 1 and plus 2. So that's just a bit more complex. We're going to have t squared plus 2t plus 1. And we're going to have plus 3t plus 3 plus another 2. And where are we left now? We've still got a t squared. And we have 2t and 3t, that gives us 5t. We have 1 plus 3 plus 2, and that equals 6. So this would be another form of parametrizing our curve, so that we have x, y that is going to equal t plus 1, and then also t squared plus 5t plus 6. And again, since our domain is the whole of the real number line, we're going to have negative infinity is less than t is less than infinity. So there we have another solution. And that's also an equally valid parametrization of this function, of this polynomial, y equals x squared plus 3x plus 2. But we want to keep things very simple. I think we'd all agree that the parametric equations here in our first solution is a bit more easier to work with than the one in our second solution. In this problem, problem 1.3 in our problem set there, just mind the previous ones where we said this problem 1, 2, and 3. This is problem 1.3. So parametrize the equation y equals sine of 3x plus cosine of x squared. Now, before we just had polynomials, and now we have transcendental function here. But it's as simple as before. And now let's just take the simplest parametrization. And we're just going to let x equals t. And then when x is t, we're just going to replace that. So for y, we're going to get, by the way, these are just my lines. I should actually, you know, just complete this so that you see that it's not minus x, in case you get confused there. So y equals the sine of 3t plus the cosine of t squared. As simple as that. And then now for my solution, my final solution, as I say, let me do that. So you can see I'm just my different bullet points. So in our final solution, we're going to have x, y, and that is going to be my parametric equations t, and then sine of 3 times t plus the cosine of t squared. And again, because we weren't told the domain of x there, we're going to just assume it goes from negative infinity is less than t is less than positive infinity. And that's our final quick and easy solution. So it doesn't matter whether this is a polynomial or transcendental function as we have here, trigonometric function. We're just going to do exactly the same by starting with x and just giving it the simplest sort of parametric function, and that'll just be t. So in problem 1.4, we have to parameterize again this very simple polynomial. We're just back to y equals x squared, but now we want to go from one point to another point. So we're not just starting at negative infinity, going to positive infinity. We want this very specific starting point and end point. And as we can see there, 1,1, so that will be down here, and then 3,9, which will be up there. So we need values for t, so that as t changes, we just stick to this little bit. We just want to stick to this little bit of the curve between 1.1 and 3.9. So as t changes, that's the only place we want to be. We want to be nowhere else. So what we have to do now, if we want to parameterize this, is the following. So we want, usually, if we start at 1.4, t to be 0 at that point. Because t, as far as parameters go, when we do apply problems, it usually refers to time, and we want to start at time equals 0. So we've got to find a new parameterized function for x, such that when t is 0, we have the fact that x equals 1. And just have a look at this. Think about this. If I say x equals 1 plus t. Now, if t is 0, I substitute 0 in there, x is 1. That's beautiful. That's exactly where we want to be. So what is y going to be? Well, it's x squared, so that's 1 plus t squared. And again, if t is 0, I'm at time equals 0, 1 plus 0 is 1, 1 squared is 1, I am at the point 1,1. So this function works for me. Now, it's not immediately obvious that it'll always work. If we change t, that, you know, it's going to work out properly for us. And it will, it just depends how t changes. Now, what we want from t equals 0, we want to go to t that is more positive. We want to move forward in time, not backwards in time. So you might find that depending on what you do for this crucial step, this, and put a little block here and a little tick mark, that just to show that that is the crucial step. Now let's have a look at what value must t take, given that this is our parametrized function, parametric functions, what values must t take for us to end up at 3.9? So we know we have this equation x equals 1 plus t. So we want x to be 3 in this instance. So if we have x equals 3, you know, what must t be? Well, at that instance, what we have now is we have the fact that 3 equals 1 plus t. So 1 plus t, that's still my value for x. And now we want x to be 3. And that's very simple to go from there, in as much as we can just solve for t, and we see t equals 2. So when t equals 2, 2 plus 1 is 3, x is indeed in position number 3 down here. So let's just see, when t equals 3, what happens to y? So we're going to have y equals 1 plus, what is t? It's now 2 squared, and indeed that's 3 squared, and that's 9. So we are in the right spot, 3,9. So we can eventually now write down our parametric equation. Now, as per usual, let me just do this so that there's no ambiguity as to, and I'm not putting minuses there, that's just the bullet points along which we are working, is the fact that we have our parametric equations now. We can say x and y, that's going to be equal to 1 plus t and 1 plus t all squared. And now we can also say, let's just make that a nice 2, we can also say that 0 is less than or equal to t is less than or equal to 2. Because it's only if t is just between those two values, that is when we are in this little section here of our curve, just between those starting point 1,1 and the end point 3,9. So again, when you have to solve this problem, you have to start with x, start with x, of course, and find some function that includes t, such as that when you make t 0, that we will be at that point, x equals 1, because that's where we have to start, there at x equals 1. And then substitute, and then you'll have to find out what the value for t is once you get to the other point. So we want x to be 3, and that's what we have there. we want x to be 3, and now we just say, well, x is now 3, and our parametric equation for x is 1 plus t, so 3 equals 1 plus t, we solve for t, and then we just see where we land up when t, and just make sure when we use t, then t equals 2, that we are at 9, which of course we will be. So we have our final parametric equations there with the domain for our parameter t. Let's do problem 1.5 on your problem set there. Find the parametric equations for y equals 2 minus x squared. And we can see the little crude drawing there. It's a parabola facing downwards and it has a y-intercept there of 2. But we want to go from the point 2 comma minus 2. So that's the point right there. And then we want to go back up to the point 0 comma 2. So we have to find values for t such that we just move along that section. So if we just want to move along that section, so how are we going to go about this? As always, finding parametrized versions of equations of our equation there, we've got to set x to be some function of t. Now remember, we would ideally want to start at t equals 0. Remember right in the first problems, I mean, there are many ways to do this, but we want to start at t equals 0. If we want to start at t equals 0, we want a function of x with respect to t that we are at point x equals 2. And then one way to do that would be say t x equals 2 and then plus or minus t. Now I'm going to choose minus t here. And you'll see that this is going to work out for us. I want you to try positive t and see if that works. Of course it's going to work, but I'll tell you what happens now. You'll have to run t backwards in time. And as again, I use the term time, but we have to see this just as a parameter, parametric variable, in as much as it's not really time, but we are using it as time here. So we want to move forward in t. T goes from 0 up. And if you use 2 plus t, that's not really going to work for you. And please do it and you'll see. Is this still valid parametric equation for x? Yes, it is, because at t equals 0, 2 minus 0 is 2, and so we are at x equals 2, just as we want it to be. So if that is my equation there, my first parametric equation, that means y must be 2 minus, and then I just substitute for x, I substitute 2 minus t squared, and let's see what that is. That's going to be 2 minus, and what do we have here? So that's 4 minus 4t plus t squared. And that is just equal to 2 minus 4, that's negative 2, plus 4t minus t squared. So I have my parametric equations now. And let's just see for what value of t, because this was for t equals 0, at what value of t are we going to end up at 0? So we have this equation now we have this equation here that we can see here as far as x is concerned. So now we just want x to be 0. So 0 equals 2 minus t. And that just means, that's very simple, that just means t equals 2. So at t equals 2, when I plug 2 in there, 2 minus 2 is 0, we will be at x equals 0. And you see now why I chose 2 minus t. If I chose 2 plus t, I would have ended up here in my last part here. I would have ended up with t equals negative 2. And that's of course not what we want. And let's just make sure, of course, that we are then, as far as y is concerned, in position 2. So let's just see what y is at t equals 2. So y at t equals 2, let's just write it there, t equals 2. And we're going to say that's our equation right up there. So that's minus 2 plus 4 times 2 minus, and we have 2 squared. So that's going to be minus 2. We're going to have plus 8, and we're going to have minus 4, and that is indeed just 2. So we are in position 0, 2. So that's exactly what we want. So we eventually have our parametric equations there. Let me just do my little tick marks here so that you can see that's what they were all about. So we're going to have x, y, and that's going to equal 2 minus t. And then this long polynomial here, minus 2 plus 4t. Why do you say long polynomial? That really isn't long. T squared, and remember now, 0 is less than or equal to t is less than or equal to 2. We found t to be 2 when we were up here. So there we have it, our final solution. So this one's just a bit more tricky. You'll have to think properly of what your crucial equation is, and the crucial one is this very first one, x equals 2 minus t. And if you said 2 plus t, that would still be valid, but as I say, then you would have to run t towards the negative side to get to the second point. So just be very careful of that. So here we are with problem 1.6. In the problem set, find the parametric equation for the line segment from the point 4, comma negative 2 to the point 2, comma negative 1. So if we look at the problem here, we see the two points here, and we want to go from this bottom point to this upper point. That's what we want. So that being said, we are reminded here, and you'll see those in the notes, the parametric equations for a line segment would just be a plus bt, comma c plus dt, and then we need to solve, find solutions for a and b and c and d, and those are just real numbers. And t is going to be on this interval from p to q. That is how we do it. So when we do these, we try to be, obviously clever about all of this, and we're going to start off with t equals 0. Because that's where we want to start at, and t equals 0, we're going to be right at that point. So at t equals 0, if we look at the equation up here, we're going to have the following. We're going to have x that's going to equal a plus b times 0. T is now 0, so x is just a, but we know what x is at that point. We're starting at the point 4, so we know a equals 4. Similar for y is going to equal c plus dt, but t here is 0. We are t equals 0, so there's nothing there. But we know we are at the starting point, 4, comma negative 2, so that's going to be negative 2, and we've already solved for a and c. Now we just have to solve for b and t. And unlike the previous problems, where we needed to find out what the value of t is going to be, here we're not so concerned because it's our choice as to what we're going to do from here on in. So let's just do that. We can decide, and we're just going to say, well, our next time step or our next parametric step is just going to be t equals 1, as simple as that. So where does that leave us? Well, it leaves us with x equals a, but we know what a is now, it's 4, plus b. Well, t is just 1, and b times 1 is just 1, so that's not a problem. And y equals, we know c is negative 2, plus d, and t again is 1, so you know, that is not an issue. And furthermore, we also know for these two points, we are now at point 2, comma negative 1. So now that means we can solve for b and we can solve for d. That's very simple. So b, in our instance, is just going to be 2 minus 4, that's negative 2. And as far as d is concerned here, d, if we just take the negative 2 over to the other side, that's going to leave us with 1. So we now have these solutions as far as a, b, c, and d are concerned. And now all that's left to do, let's just draw this line all the way down, just keep things nice and neat, is that we can write down our parametric equations. We have the fact that x, y, that is going to equals, we know what a is, we know what b is, that's 4 minus 2t, and we know it's negative 2 plus t, because d is just 1. And we know, very simple, because we chose this, 0 is less than or equal to t is less than or equal to 1. So there we have our final solution. So it's very easy actually to do these line segments, as long in green, I'll always have the definitions in green. So we have the parametric equations for a line segment, a plus bd and c plus dt, it's linear, it's lines, and we're just going to go from t equals 0 to t equals 1. And it's very simple at least to solve for the a and c when t is 1, and it's almost as simple to solve for b and d when we make t equals 1, knowing already what a and c are. So these are actually very simple problems to do. Problem 1.7 in your problem set there, find the point or points of intersection of the curves, and we can see that these curves are parametrically shown here, parametric equations here, t plus 3 and t squared, and the other one's 1 plus s and 2 minus s. So we see another parameter variable here, s. Doesn't matter really what we use. Now think about this. Where two lines intersect, two equations intersect, two curves intersect, at that point their x values are the same and their y values are the same. So if we set this to be x1 and y1, and this one x2 and y2, x1 must equal x2 because at that point of intersection the two x values are the same. And similarly for the two y values. So we can really very quickly here set up two equations and two unknowns, because if we set x1 equals x2, so let's say x1 equals x2, if we were to do that, we have the fact that t plus 3 equals 1 plus s. And when we set y1 equal to y2, we're going to have that t squared equals 2 minus s. So we have two equations and two unknowns. So let's just solve for s up here. That'll be the easiest. So we're going to have s equals, we'll take the negative 1 over to the other side. That is t plus 2. And let's substitute that into our equation here as far as s is concerned. So we're going to have t squared equals 2 minus, and we have t plus 2. And if we just simplify this, it's going to be 2, negative 2 is 0, and we're just going to have negative t. And very simply here, if we were just to go down here with t squared equals negative t, that means t squared plus t equals 0. We're going to take t out and we have t plus 1 left. That equals 0. So we have t equals 0 or t equals negative 1. So for those two values, we're going to get our lines of intersection. So let's just do this so it's nice and neat. When you want to have a look at these, let's just keep them nice and neat. So what we're going to do now is just to see at t equals 0. So what happens at t equals 0? Well, at t equals 0, let's just substitute that in as far as these two points are concerned. So if t equals 0, 0 plus 3 is 3. So I have 3. And then t squared is 0 squared, and that's 0. And when we have t equals negative 1, what point are we going to have then? Well, way up here, we can see negative 1 plus 3, well, that's just equal to 2, and negative 1 squared is 1, and there we find our two points. Nothing more to do. We can just solve for s and just make absolutely sure that there was no mistake. So let's just do that on the side here, but that's our final solution. Those are two points of intersection. So let's just solve for s. If we solve for s with t, when t equals 0 and we plug it in there, that means s equals 2. And if we plug in negative 1, we're going to get that s equals 1. And if we plug those two into our second parametric equation there, so 2 plus 1 is going to be 3, comma 2 minus 2 is 0. So I get the same point there. That's not a problem. And when s is 1, 1 plus 1 is 2. And 2 minus 1 is 1, and I get exactly the same two points. So that's not a problem there. So all we did was here, because we know what t is, we just substituted t in there so that we could solve for s. And we get exactly those two points. The crux of the matter here, of course, is to realize that when curves intersect, both of them will have to have the same x value and both will have to have the same y value. And we do that, we find these two points of intersection because we're setting up two equations in two unknowns. So here we have a lovely problem, problem 1.8 in the problem set there. Find the parametric equations for the ellipse x squared over 25 plus y squared over 144 equals 1. Now you could solve just y, get y on its own, and set a parametric equation for x and then get for t, but there's a much better way of doing it, more eloquent. And we're given a hint actually there. And when you see these problems, always think of that hint. And that's trigonometric identities. So we have the most famous one there, the easiest one, sine squared t plus cosine squared t equals 1. And what we see here, if we have a look at, let's just do that, x squared over 25. Well, 25 is just 5 squared. And if we have y squared, 144, well, that's just 12 squared, and that is 1, no problem there. But because both the numerators and denominators are squared, I could also have x over 5 all squared plus y over 12 all squared equals 1. And I have something squared plus something squared equals 1, which is what we have up here. Something squared plus something squared is 1. So what we could do, we could just say x over 5 equals the sine of t. Because if we take the square of both sides, we have x squared over 5 and sine squared. And that leaves us with the fact that if we just solve for x on its own, x equals 5 times the sine of, let's put that in parentheses, t. And we also have that y over 12, well, we can set that equal to the cosine of t. And that means for us that we have y equals 12 times the cosine of t. And you can clearly see that, you know, of course, if we just let, if we just make these squares, that becomes a square. If we make these squares, it becomes a square. But we just leave, you know, take the square root of both sides, and this is what we're left with. And now it's very simple for us to write our parametric equation, in as much as we're going to have x, y, and that's going to be 5 times the sine of t, and we're going to have 12 times the cosine of t. And we're not given for x, we're not given any domain there, so we're just going to have negative infinity is less than t is less than positive infinity. And we have our solution there. So if you saw the hint there, you'll see that it's actually very simple to do. And whenever you see problems like this, please remember that you could probably use one or two a couple of parametric equations to solve this kind of problem. Another one of these problems, find the parametric equations for the hyperbola x squared over a squared minus y squared over b squared equals 1. Now you see the hints there. You know that we're going to use trigonometric identities here. And if it wasn't for the hints, let's just do the most famous one, sine squared of, I'm going to use t because we're dealing with parametric equations, plus cosine squared of t equals 1. And that's not what we want, though, because this is an equation here for a hyperbola, and so we have minus y squared over b squared. So that's not going to help us. But it's very easy, if you can't remember the one that contains secant and tangent, it's just to divide both sides by the cosine squared of t. So if I divide this by cosine squared of t, this by cosine squared of t, and this by cosine squared of t, what I'm going to be left with, sine over cosine is tangent, so that's the tangent squared of t. Cosine squared over cosine squared, that's this 1. 1 over cosine squared is secant squared of t. And all that's left to do is just to take the tangent over to the other side, so we're going to have the secant squared of t minus the tangent squared of t equals 1, and that's exactly what we want, because what we have here, in essence, is that's x over a, all squared, minus y over b, all squared, equals 1. So we have something squared minus something squared is 1, which is exactly what we have here with our trigonometric identity. So very simple here, we can say x equals x over a, that is, that's going to equal the secant of t. Remember, as with the previous problem, let's not bother to do the squares there, because it's just another step. And then y over b, that's going to be the tangent of t, which means we can very easily solve for x here. X is going to be a times the secant of t. And here we're going to have y equals b times the tangent of t, which means that we have our parametric equations. So let's just do this. It's all nice and neat. So there was step number one, another step. Here's our final step. And as much as we have our parametric equations, x, y, and that's going to equal a times the secant. Let's make it look neat. And then b times the tangent of t. And again, we weren't given any domain here, so we're going to go from negative infinity is less than t is less than positive infinity. So where we go, in one step we learned how to remember, if we can't remember, how to get to the secant and tangent squared trigonometric identities. And you'll see the second hint there, because there's this deeper connection between this hyperbola here and the hyperbolic trigonometric functions. So remember that there is another trigonometric identity for hyperbolic trigonometric functions, and that says that the hyperbolic cosine squared of a value minus the hyperbolic sine function squared, that equals 1. So in that instance, we would also have the fact that we have these squares, so we're going to have that x equals a times the hyperbolic cosine of t, and then y was always going to then be b times the hyperbolic sine function of t, and then we're going to have our parametric equations x comma y, that is going to be a times cosh of t and b times the sinj. It's very awkward pronunciations there, and again we're going to have negative infinity is less than t is less than positive infinity. So that was going to be the second trigonometric identity that we can use, and we can now start to see this connection between the hyperbola, which we had up here, our hyperbola that we have up here, and our trigonometric identity as far as hyperbolic trigonometric functions are concerned. So there you go, two solutions to this problem 1.9. Let's go for problem number 10. Find the parametric equations for x to the power 2/3 plus y to the power 2/3 equals a to the power 2/3. If you can't read there, those are 2/3. Now, we certainly don't know trigonometric identity as far as these things are concerned until we realize that, well, there's something we can do about this problem. And as much as we can rewrite this as x to the power 1/3 all squared, and we can write that as y to the power 1/3, and we can write that as all squared, and that equals a to the power 1/3 all squared. And remember, those are the properties of powers, so there's no problem there. And we can also divide both sides by the right-hand side. So we're going to have x to the power 1/3 all squared, and we're going to divide that by a to the power 1/3 all squared, and we're going to have y to the power 1/3. This is all very laborious, and I'm quite sure you can already see where we're going with this. And that's a to the power 1/3 all squared, and that equals 1. And we're just back to sine squared of t plus cosine squared of t equals 1, because we have something squared plus something squared equals 1. So we have the fact that x to the power 1/3 over, let's just write the whole thing out, then it's going to be a to the power 1/3, that is going to equal the sine of t, because that's all squared, and sine squared of t, and from that we know now that x to the power 1/3, x to the power 1/3 is going to be a to the power 1/3 sine of t, and we can take that even further by taking the exponent to the power, or taking what we have on the left hand side to the power 3, and on the right hand side to the power 3. That just leaves us with x, that leaves us with a, and that leaves us with the sine to the power 3 of t. And we're going to have exactly the same here when it comes to y to the power 1/3 over a to the power 1/3. Well, that's just got to equal cosine of t, the cosine of t there. That means we can just solve here for y to the power 3. That's going to be a to the power 3 cosine of t. And then we just take both sides to the power 3. In other words, y is going to equal a cosine to the power 3 t. And we eventually have our parametric equations x comma y. And that is just going to equal a sine to the power 3 of t. And we're going to have a cosine to the power 3 of t, and again we weren't given any domain there, so we just can say negative infinity is less than t is less than positive infinity, and that's it. So it was very easy to change what we had way up there as far as our problem was concerned, to change that into something that we can use a trigonometric identity, and all we had to use was just a very simple trigonometric identity. So just remember here, we actually just skip a step as much as this step here. So let me just write it out. Actually, what we have here is x to the power 1/3 over 8 to the power a third, and these are, both of them are squared, so the whole thing is squared, and remember that is equal to sine squared of t, and we're just taking the square root of both sides, and that's where we end up with this here. We've just skipped a step and not done the whole squared. I suppose we skipped another step where we can have the square of the numerator and denominator separately and then write it as such. But remember, all we're doing here is we're using the trigonometric identity sine squared of t plus cosine squared of t equals 1. As simple as that. And that's what we have here, summing squared plus summing squared, that equals 1. And we can just simply equate those two equations, the left-hand side to the left-hand side and the right-hand side to the right-hand side, and then each little expression to itself, the first one to sine and the second one to cosine. Very simple. Problem number 11, that's the last problem in this first set. Find the parametric equations for x squared plus y squared equals 4y. And of course, our minds have got to jump to the fact that we can use the parametric trigonometric identities here. But as the problem is stated now, that will not be possible. So let's just see if we can do something about it. X squared plus y squared, and let's bring it all to the one side, minus 4y equals 0. And we see the hint there that we can just complete the square. So look at this, if we say x squared plus y squared minus 4y, if we do plus 4 and if we do it on this side, we have to do it on the other side, maintain equality there. So if x squared plus, and if I have y minus 2 squared, that equals 2 squared on the right-hand side. Look, y minus 2 all squared, so that would be y squared minus 4y plus 4, exactly what we want. And now we can say x squared, and we can divide both sides by 4, so that's 2 squared, plus y minus 2 squared over 2 squared, and 2 squared divided by 2 squared is 1. And lo and behold, I have another situation where I can use the trigonometric identity sine squared plus cosine squared of t equals 1. Because what I have here on the left-hand side is summing squared plus summing squared, so I'm going to have the fact that x squared divided by, let's just put the 4 there, that's going to equal the sine squared of t. And if we were to just solve for that, we've got squares on both sides. In other words, x is going to equal 2 times the sine of t. Remember, if we take the square root of 4, that's 2. And we're also going to have the fact that y minus 2, let's just skip that step of squaring everything, that is going to equal the cosine of t. In other words, if we go there, it means y minus 2 equals 2 times the cosine of t. And I've got to simplify that even further to get my parametric equations. Y equals twice the cosine of t plus 2. We've got to bring that 2 over to the other side, and eventually I have my two parametric equations, and as far as that is 2 times the sine of t, and this one's going to be 2 times the cosine of t plus 2, and remember negative infinity is less than t is less than positive infinity. So there we go, a very quick problem. You've just got to realize that there's so many techniques that you've learned about before. They are in your head, you just remember, and you will remember them, and it's just about, you know, when to pull them out, which one to think about, and it only comes from doing a lot of these problems. So with the hint there that we had, at least, was just to complete the square. And if we complete the square, we just sat with a very simple trigonometric identity substitution. So those were the 11 problems in the problem set as far as just working with parametric equations are concerned. In the second step, we're actually going to create curves, and very excitingly, we're going to use a computer language to create those curves for us so that we can sort of develop a better intuition for what's going on, and also I suppose as important, give us the ability to play around with the values and see how these curves come out other than doing it by hand. So let's answer the next 9 questions, and that's where we actually have to create these curves. We have to draw them. Now certainly if you are in class for a test or exam, you're going to perhaps be required to do this by hand. And that is fun for the first couple of times, and it gives you a little bit of intuition as to what's going on. But I think it's much more useful to use a computer language to draw these curves. And any kind of curve plots parametric curves, as we're going to do here, parametric equations, or curves of parametric equations. Because you can play around, because you just have to change one or two things in a line of code and you get a new curve, and you can actually see before your eyes how these things develop and how they change based on the parameters that or change in the parametric equations themselves. So I think it's just much easier to do a lot of these. And if you do a lot of these, you can start seeing patterns and how these things differ. So the language that we're going to use is just the Wolfram language. I want you to go to wolframcloud.com, because you can open a browser window in wolframcloud.com and you can just write the code all free of charge. Just use the Wolfram language. What I've got here and wolframcloud.com, so I've logged in. So you can just create a free account. But I do have an account. Mine's called Wolfram One, and it's a personal account. And it costs me a couple of cups of coffee a month. That's it. You know, for what you get, it's absolutely phenomenal. And then it also gives you the ability to download the desktop version of the Mathematica, so that you can use the Wolfram language on your own desktop. So that's absolutely fantastic. And so do that, and then you can just create a new notebook, because a notebook is what we write our code in. I just want to show you around a little bit. On the top here, if you click on documentation, you are going to see the Wolfram language documentation. That's like a massive thick textbook. And you can see they've got core language, data manipulation analysis, visualization and graphics, machine learning, symbolic and numerical computation, higher mathematical computation, strings, graphs, images, geometry, sound and video, knowledge representation and natural language, time-related computation, scientific and medical data and computation. The list goes on and on. And you can just click on this and, you know, these things open up and you can see what a list is all about, for instance, all the functions that exist for list. You can click on one of them and it'll tell you how this function works, and a little bit of example code. So you have a whole, in the documentation here, you have a whole textbook of how the Wolfram language works. That's fantastic. If we click on language info, we get Fast Intro for Programmers, Elementary Introduction Book, Stephen Wolfram's book, and Elementary Introduction Course you can actually take. And if you go for Fast Introduction for Programmers, that's a nice little online book that you can go through, teach yourself. Now, I've got three massive open online courses on the Wolfram language online. The first one is from Coursera. All the links will be in the description down below, that I've done for the University of Cape Town. And you can earn a certificate from the University of Cape Town for the completion of that course. And that's all about healthcare, well, a bit more general, but also healthcare and life science statistics. I've got two courses on Udemy, one specifically for healthcare statistics and using the Wolfram language, and the other one just a generic introduction to the use of the Wolfram language. And you can certainly check those out. So let's go back, and then we get to quick links. So quick links, just from some useful things. There's a 1 minute video about using notebooks, for instance, education and training, all sorts of resources. Anyway, let's go to the Wolfram Cloud, and what we have here right on the right hand side is the cloud files. So here's all my little hard drive, you can say, in the cloud, and I can just click there and I can create a new folder. So if you were to create a new folder, there's going to be folder one. I can click on the little wheel there and say rename it, and let's call it my folder. And now I have a folder there, my folder, and I can go into that folder by double clicking on it. And here I can create a new notebook, or just with that little button, or upload files if I have some files to upload, like spreadsheet files, we want to do some data analysis, etc. So let's just go home, because I've saved everything in YouTube. This is my course on vector calculus. It's part number one, parametric equations. And inside of section one, parametric equations, part one is just this, just parametric equations. We've just done a bunch of example problems, and the notebook I want to show you is parametric curves. So if we double click on that, that's what's going to open up. So there we go. This is what a notebook looks like. And I've prepared everything for you. There you can see that we're busy with problems 2, so 2.1 through 2.9. And we're going to generate those curves. Now you can see how beautiful this is, a notebook. You can see on the right-hand side there these cells, bigger cells with sub-cells and sub-sub-cells, etc. And you can see what happens if you hover your cursor in between these, it goes horizontal. And if you click there, a little plus sign opens there, so you can enter some code in a text cell there, freeform input, Wolfram Alpha, which you've all heard about, plain text or some other style. And if you click on some other style, you can select between a title, subtitle, section, subsection, all the way down, all sorts of things. So this cell is a title cell, and you can just start typing then. There, and this is a section cell, subsection cell. So you just create in between there, you can just insert little cells that you can use. So this is not a course on the use of the Wolfram language, so please look at all these resources. But I think even if you don't do any of those, you're going to pick this up very, very quickly. So the way the Wolfram language works, it's a functional language. So everything is done with a function, and there are over 6,000 functions. I mean, you could see here under documentation, if we were to go here under the documentation, there's very little inside of the stem and beyond, that's not there. Higher mathematics, we can look at polynomial algebra, tensor algebra, linear algebra, discrete calculus, neural networks, probability theory, random processes, discrete math, number theory, group theory. It's just all you can do. You can do everything with the language. So what we are doing at the moment is just going to do some plotting. So there's a plot function, so plot, and we have to pass the plot function some information so that it can know what to do. Those things are called parameters, and they go inside of a set of square brackets. So you see the opening and closing square brackets there. And everything that is passed here, they're called parameters, as I said, and we separate the parameters by a comma. Okay, so the first parameter, in other languages we call them arguments, is what I want to plot. I want to plot x squared. Now, in most computer languages, the caret symbol there is a power notation. It's shift 6 on my keyboard, most keyboards, so x to the power 2, so x squared. I want to plot x squared, but I've got to tell the plot function over what domain I want this. So what values must x take? So this is called a list because it's inside of curly braces and all the elements are separated by commas. So I say for my x-axis, so my domain, I want to go from -3 to +3. And if I hold down the shift key and hit return or enter, that cell is going to be executed and I have a beautiful graph here, this parabola y equals x squared. Now I can add some more parameters to this. Now we're not talking the parameters that we have in parametric equations, parameters as far as a computer language are concerned. Let's do the following. We still have x squared. We still have this domain from -3 to 3, but now I want to put a label on the top of my graph, and for that we have an argument or a parameter called plot label. And that little sign there is very easy to create. You just type minus greater than, and it'll be turned into this. So let's do this by hand so that you can just see at least once. So I'm going to write plot, and you see every function inside of the Wolfram language that starts with plot is going to pop up there, and you can just select from them. So plot is the one we want anyway. If you click this little chevron sign, it'll give you some hints as to what to do. There you saw my function, and then x going from x min to x max. So definitely you can just do that, and it sort of helps you out so that you can say x squared, and I can hit, I can go to my x there, that's x, and it's going to go from -3, and it's going to go to 3. But what I want to do, I want to add plot label, and I'm just going to say minus greater than, and immediately it changes into that little arrow. And then inside of quotation marks, because this is a string, just some text, I'm just going to use polynomial. So let's execute that, and now I have my plot, but there's also polynomial there. By the way, there's some things that open up here at the bottom, so I can change my background, I can add a fill, I can change the image size, and I can, as far as the axis is concerned, I can turn them off or turn them a different color. And all that's going to do, it's going to create a new line of code, and it's going to add parameters to enact these things that you have chosen. So let's add something else, and that this time around we're going to add a plot range. And we see an outside set of curly braces and then two inside sets of curly braces. This one is for the domain, and this one's for the range, or the codomain, let's put it that way. So I want the x-axis to go from negative 5 to 5, and the y-axis from negative 1 to 10. So instead of this being done automatically, I want to force how big this window is. And there you go, and you can see we have a bit more wiggle room here because we go down to negative 1, we go up to 10, whereas by default, you know, it just went slightly beyond, and it went up to about the 9abouts. So you can set this window in which it's plots. And then we can go a step further. So you still see my whole plot function here that we had before. Let me just highlight the whole one. So there's the opening and closing. You can see the highlighted bit there, the opening closing square brackets and the plot function. But it all becomes the first parameter in the manipulate function. So there's the first parameter and the comma, and there's the second one. So there's the let's just try and highlight it. There's the second one. So manipulate says, I'm going to do everything same plot x squared, and x go from negative 3 till omega. And to get that omega is very easy. You hit escape, W escape, and it turns into the Greek letter omega. There you could also use O. So I'm going to say on my x-axis go from negative 3 to omega, but this manipulate goes right till the end. It says take omega and go from negative 2 to 3. So what's going to happen, my x little window is going to go negative 3 to 2, negative 3 to negative, negative 3 to negative 2, negative 3 to negative 1, negative 3 to 0, negative 3 to 1, negative 3 to 2, negative 3 to 3. So it's just going to cycle between that start and end value. So let me show you what happens when we do this, use this manipulate function. So I get this little W slider up here. So at the moment, at the first go, W is negative 2. So that W is now going to take the value negative 2. So I'm going to say plot x squared from minus 3 to minus 2. But as I slide this along, as I make omega more and more, I'm plotting more of, or I'm inputting at least more of the domain of x. And I can even click on that little plus symbol there, so I can just go back and forth little steps. It's taking steps of 0.5. You can actually set the step size, but we won't worry about that now. So that's in short just how to plot. It's actually quite easy. So let's get to these problems. So what I'm going to do, just increase the screen size a little bit. There we go. Let's look at problem 1. So 2.1 then on your problem set. We have the parametric equation, which was 5 minus t squared and t over 2. So I'm going to put that inside of my parametric plot function. There's my parametric plot function, and I'm passing as a list, because it's curly braces with a comma in between two elements, my two parametric equations. And then I'm going to say my parameter, and the problem, the parameter, the t goes from 0 to 4, but instead of going from 0 to 4, I'm going to go from 0 to omega, and right here at the omega, I'm going to go from just beyond 0.01 till 4. And I'm going to show you what's going to happen, and then this plot range, remember, that's just to set my window, the window size that I want to plot, my domain and my codomain. So if we do this, and that's why I say why this is so beautiful, because now we can see what happens as my parameter t changes, because I'm letting t go from 0 to 0.01, so it's just at the beginning there, by 5, and then 0.02, so it goes from 0 to 0.02, and eventually we're going to go all the way from 0 to 4. So let's just open this so that I can just click through it, and you can see how the function starts growing, and that's why we say the parameter allows us to move along the equation that we have. So to parameterize the function means I can move along the function, and all we're doing here is just to show as my t value grows from the beginning to the end. So we have t going from 0 to 4. As we go from 0 to 4, we can see this part of the plot for which we have a domain for this parameter. The second one is 3 cosine of t and 3 sine of t. So you can see them there. Now in the Wolfram language, if you leave a space, you can see there's a space between the 3 and the c for cosine. Now cosine is uppercase C, and then always uppercase because it's a function, one of the 6,000 plus functions, and all the functions start with uppercase letters there. So the space means multiplication. So there is a little space there. So you can't just say 3 and directly the C, as we would if we write on paper. You've got to leave that space. Alternatively, you can wipe out the space and just put a star there. Shift 8 on my keyboard. So that's the same as just leaving, as just the leaving a space. Once we have a space there, it also means multiplication. So 3 times the cosine of t, 3 times the sine of t, and we're going from 0 to pi. Once again, I'm going from 0, and I'm going to set this omega to go from 0.01 to pi. So eventually t will go from 0 to pi, and I've got my little window there, so that we can sort of start to see what happens as our parameter goes from its start position to our end position. So you can see what 3 times the cosine of t, 3 times the sine of t. So x equals 3 times cosine of t, y equals 3 times the sine of t, and I'm going from 0 to pi, and that's a half circle. So that is the parametric equations for a half circle with a radius of 3. And you can just very quickly change this to 4, for instance. Make that a 4 and make that a 4, and you'll see that the radius grows by 4. Or you can take t and you can divide it by 2 and see what the effect is. And that's what I mean. It can help you very quickly see what these look like. Let's go to problem number 2.3. We have, remember with the problems we had, if we have a line segment, that's a plus bt and then c plus dt. So this is definitely going to be a line segment. So if we plot that line segment, and let's just go right to the end, and you can see that it's going to be a line segment from a starting position to an end position. Of course, we can see where we start and where we end by using the manipulate function. Problem 2.4, I have t squared minus 3 and t cubed minus t, going from negative 2 to 2, as far as the parameter is concerned. Again, I'm going to use the manipulate function, so we can see how this develops over time. Let me just move down so you can see. That's really a fascinating parametric equations here. Look at that. That's not a function that you'll just draw y equals x squared, for instance. Now, remember the vertical line test. So what we have here, you know, is not really a function, but it is something that we can express with a pair of parametric equations. Beautiful. The next one is t cubed minus t, and then y is t to the power of 4 minus 2t squared plus 2. And we're going to go from minus 2 to 2. But then I'm starting at negative 1.99. So it's negative 2 to negative 1.99. And then eventually we work our way up to omega being 2. So the parameter t goes from negative 2 to 2. So let's see what this does as it goes, as it goes, as it goes, as it goes. Interesting stuff. And you can see, as the parameter changes, what happens to this function. 2.6, we have 3 times the cosine of 2t plus sine of 5t, 3 times the sine of 2t plus cosine of 5t, we're going from negative 4 to 4. So let's have a look at what this complicated function would look like, parametric equations would look like. So let's have a look. You can see it making a little start there. Let's go, let's go, let's go. Let's go, so it's going to be this 5-pointed, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7-pointed star. There we go. It's beautiful in what you can create with these parametric equations. Just remember that there's a little space there between the 3 and the C. There's a space between the 2 and the T there, between the 5 and the T, just to indicate that those are multiplications. So just be aware of that. Now we wanted to see in problem 2.7 the effect of K. And I'm still going to use manipulate, but instead of k going from one value to the others, I'm going to say k, comma, and then another little list. So k is going to be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8. And I'll show you what that does. That just gives us this little drop-down box here to play with. So when k is 2, that's what happens. When k is 3, this is what happens. When k is 4, this is what happens. Let's go to 6. And let's go to 8, and you can play to your heart's content to see. And this is very nice when it comes to working with, say, with waves and vibrations, for instance. We're going to see these kinds of parametric equations. Problem 2.8, that's the hyperbolic cosine. X equals the hyperbolic cosine of t, and y equals the hyperbolic sine of t. And we're going from 0, all the way to pi over 2. So let's have a look at what that looks like. And let's go right to the end so we can see this, and we can see when we go only go to pi over 2, it's this upper half of this hyperbola, and that's why we have this hyperbolic functions, trigonometric functions. That's where it comes from. Now, if we use the trigonometric identity that the cosine, hyperbolic cosine squared of t minus hyperbolic sine of t, both of them squared, that's going to equal to 1. So we can actually solve for this, and what we're going to get is the square root. So there's the square root function of x squared minus 1 and negative the square root of x squared minus 1. So if we were to draw that, you can see I'm just using the plot function, and because I want to plot two things, I'm going to put them inside of a list and separate them by a comma. And there you go. Last problem, 2.9. We wanted to look at a times t minus a times the sine of t and a minus a times the cosine of t. And we're going to go from negative 4 pi to positive 4 pi. And we want to know, you know, what kind of function this is, what kind of curve we have here. And we can clearly see it's a cycloid. And if a increases, it's just going to increase the size of these things. So that is very definitely a cycloid. And in the next section, we're going to work out the derivatives of these functions. And we're going to ask, at what slope does this cycloid meet the x-axis every time? But we're specifically just going to say here at x equals 0, at what slope does the cycloid hit? So we'll have to take a derivative, and we'll have to take the derivative here, and we're going to do it from the right-hand side as we approach from the right-hand side towards x equals 0, because you can clearly see we have we don't have a continuous curve here. We have this sharp cusp here. So certainly we're going to have some problems as far as our derivative is concerned, but you'll see, I'll let the cat out the box, the fact that it meets the x-axis right down in a perpendicular fraction orthogonal, in as much as the slope is going to go way up to infinity right there. And that's how it meets the x-axis, so that's clearly a cycloid. So yes, do it by hand, but during the course of this course, I'm going to show you how easy it is to use the Wolfram language. You're probably going to stop doing a bit of parametric equations now just to check out some of these resources on wolframcloud.com. Just open a free account and start playing. I'll put, as I said, the links in the description down below as to some of the courses. And if you really want to take an easy, nice introduction to it, look at my course on Udemy, which is an introduction to Mathematica or the Wolfram language.